Hello, all you werewolf fans out there. It is your horror host, Benjamin Dutil, with the Horror Heathen YouTube channel and the South Jersey Horror Podcast. Today with me, I have a very special guest, a legendary actress, who you all know as Belinda Balaski, who I will be talking today about her role as Terry Fisher in the awesome, nostalgic werewolf movie, The Howling, from 1981. One of my all-time favorite werewolf movies from the 80s. And I cannot get enough of this movie. I think I've watched it maybe 100 times in my lifetime so far. And it's still stuck with me, and it's still an awesome movie to this day. So, Ms. Balaski, how are you doing today? Thank you for joining me.
I'm very good. Thank you. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How is California, by the way? How is L.A.?
Well, it was raining earlier, like really raining hard, and I'm really glad it stopped because I figured it would mess up our sound, and, you know, a spectrum, a wind can take it out. I should have said that, but you know what I mean?
Well, I've been to L.A. before when I was just a wee kid. I barely remember L.A. All I do remember is staying at my aunt's house and not her house. I think it was like an apartment, but which was literally right down the street from Warner Brothers Studios. So,
from which studio?
Warner Brothers.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. And he and I would take trips down there every once in a while, you know, to see if we could catch like a celebrity coming out of the gate or something, or the limousine. We never did, which is heartbreaking, but we had hopes. We had high hopes. But
that's cute.
At one point we thought we saw George Burns because we saw this big cigar hanging out the window as he tapped it a couple of times to shake the ash off. And I was
oh
like,
my gosh.
Did we just see George Burns? And my brother looks at me like, I have no idea, man. I mean, it could be, it's possible. All we saw was a hand. So maybe we had that one lucky time. So
hard to tell with just a hand and a cigar.
Right.
A lot of people smoke cigars.
It could have been anybody, but we're gonna go with George Burns. This is back in the late.
You guys can believe it was George.
Yeah, this is in the back of the late 80s. So I was maybe like 9 or 10 years old. So anyway, reading your background, very impressive background, by the way. You've been through a lot of you starred in a lot of horror movies. And which I'll be asking you a question about that later. So you began acting at a very young age of 5. That's impressive. How did you get into acting at the age of 5?
Well, actually, I was dancing. My mother was a dance teacher. So the first lessons we got were dance, right? And I did this performance where, because I was little, I was really little, they selected me to do this thing with this big, you know, buff guy of he couldn't lift the barbells and I go up and lift them, right? And I got such a response from the audience that, you know, I was pretty sure I was on the right track. But the truth is, when I was 5 years old, I was walking down the hall, like early in the morning, no one was awake in our house. And I was going to go tell my parents I was awake, and I'm walking down the hall and I heard this voice, and I'm not kidding. I heard this voice and it said, your life is going to be about communication. You're going to be an actor. I looked up because I assumed it was God, and I said, okay. And that's pretty much how it started. I started writing little movies and plays and casting the neighborhood kids and charging the parents to come. And, you know, just that was the beginning of everything for me. It was his voice.
That's incredible.
It's a true story.
That is incredible. I mean, apparently they chose the right person to play all these roles in these movies because you are talented. I mean, just watching you alone in The Howling, I was like, oh my goodness. I mean, I never really took the time to actually watch your character in the movie. So I'm always focusing like on Dee Wallace or I can't remember the other actors, all the other actors. Yeah. But watching you, I was like, okay, I told him I'd sit down with my fiance, watching the movie. I was like, okay, I really need to sit down and watch Belinda's character so I can get an idea of what I'm getting into, what kind of questions I need to ask. And Your character is like the Nancy Drew of the entire movie. It just wants to know everything. She's an
It's
investigative
true.
reporter. She's like, I want answers. And I can relate because I'm in the same type of person. I want answers. I need to know everything what's going on around me. And maybe that's what gets me in trouble half the time. I don't know.
It
Because
certainly got you this job, I'm sure.
but I was never bitten by a werewolf. So I mean
Right. Well,
but
that's good because he was bitten by a werewolf and lives, becomes a werewolf himself.
yes. I don't know if that's a true fact. I mean, scientists can kiss my butt. It's been proven in movies over and over, time and time again.
It's
So
true.
I want to mention that you made tons of guest appearances in television series, honored with an Emmy Award. Pardon my
No,
language,
I
but
was nominated for two
oh
Emmys. I
no.
did not
No.
win, but I was not producer
Oh.
nominated by the producers, which is really cool. One was Charlton Heston and his son nominated me for Proud Men that I did with Chuck. He always said, call me Chuck. And I kept saying, Mr. Heston, I can't do that. But it was Peter Strauss and Charlton and myself. And yeah, so that was really fun to do.
I
TV
bet.
is really fun. Those were movies of the week, and that was a really fun movie of the week because we were around horses and when we because Mr. Heston did not like working with the Teamsters. We would drive so many miles out of town. If you're a certain 1 mile over that, then you don't have to have Teamsters on the set. So we were up in Santa Clarita. Yeah, which is just outside the mileage. And sure enough, by day two, suddenly there were all these trucks arrived in town, driving in circles and raising this dust that absolutely made it impossible for us to shoot. And yes, it was the Teamsters. They came in droves to drive Mr. Heston crazy. And we tried to film around that, but we really couldn't. So he ended up sending everybody home, and we came back about 11 days later. But he had to carry everybody those days, you know. And when we came back, they didn't come back, so we were able to shoot. But there was, yeah, difficult stuff, you know, when you're dealing with unions and the Teamsters. You know, his take was that, you know, they only do their own job. Like if there's something on the ground and it's not their job, they don't pick it up or touch it, you know? Whereas I'll walk by and pick it up, do you know? And a normal person might pick it up, but they don't. They just leave it and walk on. And that kind of drove him crazy.
Well, you got to work alongside Charlton Heston. He's also a legendary actor too.
He
I've
was
heard.
amazing. He was saying the whole time, he's like, I want to do a scene with you. I want to do a scene with you. And I'm like, well, okay, let's write one, you know, because Fraser, his son, was producing and it was their puppy. But the story really wasn't about my character. It was about Peter being his son and going AWOL from Vietnam. So it was really, you know, a story about war. And there was no reason to have a scene between Charlton and I. But it was very flattering for him to say so.
The very first movie I seen Charlton Heston in was Ben-Hur, the original Ben-Hur. And
Right.
we were watching that in my world history class in high school. And then I loved the movie. I went out to the library a week later and rented the movie from the library. It's just.
Yeah, no, it's a good, great movie, and it's
Yeah.
a good soundtrack too.
So back to your role in The Howling. Do you realize that this movie actually paved the way for other werewolf movies to be featured in the 1980s? I mean,
Yes.
that has truly has to be an honor because you have no idea of what, you know, other there are three other werewolf movies that came out in the 1980s. After The Howling came out American Werewolf in London.
They all came
So
out at the same time, it felt like. They all came out the same weekend. It was like Wolfen, American Werewolf in London, and The Howling. So to this day, I've never seen American Werewolf in London, and I've never seen Wolfen because I felt like I'd be betraying our camp, you know? So I haven't seen them
but
yet.
so this is for me, as being a big, huge horror fan, I would have to say, and I don't care what anyone, how they critique me, I love The Howling. It's a lot better than American Werewolf in London. Yes, I mean, the American Werewolf in London may have grossed more money, but The Howling is what started everything. And I, it's great. It's a great movie. The practical special effects, the makeup, everything. I mean,
It's between
it's.
John Sayles writing it, who is just absolutely is brilliant, because the book wasn't, and Joe Dante directing, and Rob Bottin, God love him, just this most amazing special effects man who I adore. Of course, I had done Piranha with him, and had all these piranhas hanging from me. I've done a lot of stuff with Rob, and I just adore him. When he In the Howling, he when we were actually shooting the Howling, he hadn't finished the werewolf. So like all of my close-ups are like the whole scene in the office, we didn't know what the werewolf was going to look like. He hadn't finished it and we had to shoot, So Joe's like, "We're just going to do your close-ups." I'm like, "Okay, what's how big is he? What's he doing?" He's like, "I don't know." Right? And Joe would kick the gurney at me and I would just try to survive each moment, And so those were my close-ups. And then 3 months later, I had gone back to Hawaii. 3 months later, I got the call, "The werewolf's finished. Come to your two shots." I'm like, "Wait a minute, you want me to match shots that I did 3 months ago? Are you serious?" And he's like, "Yes, I'm serious." So now I'm like, oh my gosh. So I get back here and I say to Gigi, who was the makeup lady, I'm like, "My hair is a little bit longer." And she's like, no, it's not. I have Polaroids." And I'm like, "No, it's about 2 inches longer." And she's like, "No, it's not." And I said, "No, you need to trim it." And she's like, "No, it looks perfect." I'm like, "Okay. Well, if you watch that scene in slow motion, you can see my hair go like this." Because it was 2 inches longer.
I'm gonna have to definitely go back and watch that now, because now that you mentioned it.
It's very funny because it's very obvious my hair was quite a bit longer, and that's the only place the editing is seamless. You really don't realize, that he wasn't in the same room at the same time. Once he got there, then yes, there were things we did together, but there's so much we did without the werewolf, imagining just with our imaginations.
Yeah, but still, your character was that unstoppable, spunky, investigative reporter who just was on a mission and just did not want to stop.
It's
And
true.
I was like, these are the type of people I love watching in movies. For those that just they're moving with a purpose, and you just have to put all your undivided attention on that character,
It's so
because.
funny. I have so many because I do these conventions now, and people, grown men say, "I wanted to save you. I wanted to get in the movie and save you." And it's like, "Oh, that's so nice. Why didn't you?" That I, if it made people feel that way, then my character was very successful.
Yes, you played Terry very well, top-notch acting. I mean, I tell this to all the actors that I interview, that I'm a very hard person to impress, and I'm a very hard critiquer. But you played Terry Fisher so well, so phenomenally done. It's extraordinary. I mean, forget Dee Wallace at the moment. I'm watching you.
Thank you. I don't want to
So.
forget D. I love D, but yeah, I appreciate that. Thank
I
you.
mean, no disrespect towards Dee Wallace. She's a
No,
fantastic
I
actress as
adore
well.
her.
But you, that I had to watch you, and like, this is my gal. I got she's the top one in the movie right now. So I'm like, and it's sad watching your character die. I was like, oh man, it really sucks. I mean,
Yeah,
such a
I
good
thought so
character.
too. In fact, I
Such a
told
good
Dee
character.
a couple of weekends ago we were in Vegas doing a convention. I said, "Yeah, your takeover my death scene left me a little cold, Dee. I thought I was supposed to be your best friend in all of this, And she comes in, she goes, and then she walks away. It was like, okay. Pretty funny.
What really bugs me is, like, you were so close to getting answers too, and yet your character dies. I'm like, oh man, that really sucks. I mean,
Right. I know. I was connecting the dots. I mean, I literally was connecting the dots.
So the scene where you're being chased out of the house and you chop the guy's arm off the hatchet. That was one of the coolest scenes you've done in the movie. I mean, it's being chased and you're chopping the hand off and you're watching the hand transform back into a human hand. And
Well, of course, that
at
was
point,
special effects, and that wasn't happening in front of me. But it was just me and John Sayles in this tiny little shed. I mean, it was such a tiny space that Joe couldn't even get in there to see what we were doing. It was like you got to trust John and I that we're
yeah.
doing the right thing, because he could barely get his camera in that little space. But that was really fun to do because I told Joe didn't want me to jump out the window. He said, I have a stunt person. Well, I saw the stunt person. She was like three times bigger than I was. And I was like, this is so not going to work. I've got to jump out the window. So I did tell John Hara, I said, I'm going to jump. He said, okay. And John and Joe kept saying, don't jump. Whatever you do, don't jump. Right. And I'm like, okay. But John knew I was going to. So, when I went, he kept that camera running and I was really glad it totally worked. I guess I could have hurt myself, but there was a mattress there. It was everything there, I
Yeah.
was totally safe.
Well, I'm glad you did it because I think I would have known the difference between you and someone three times your size.
Thank you. I mean, I knew everybody in the audience would just completely react, it's hard to hide something like that, And then I run from Mendocino all the way to Griffith Park. Oh no, and on to Big Bear. I mean, that whole running scene when we left Mendocino, I guess they didn't have enough footage. So they said, come up to Griffith Park. We're going to do some more running. And I did some more running there. And then a few days later, I got a call saying, we're going to go to Big Bear and we're going to do some running there. And I run all over the place. I'm running and running like crazy.
So where was this actually filmed at?
Mostly Mendocino.
I have no idea that my
Oh,
geography is not that good.
Mendocino is like above San Francisco. It's like on your way to Oregon, almost.
Okay.
It's not that far up, but it's up there,
Okay. So woods, ticks, deer, you name it, it's all there. Just
It is. The cabin is there. In fact, I was talking to somebody who recently went there and they said, the cabin's there. I said, yeah, the cabin's there. Like it didn't go away. It wasn't a set, it was a real cabin. Yeah, the office was up there, I think. Oh, that part of the office was, and then some of it that what happened on a set down here. This stuff with Patrick McNee, I think we were on a soundstage. I was so excited to meet Patrick McNee. I don't know if you've seen the blooper reel, but I think I actually he used the take in the movie where I was so excited to meet Patrick McNee that and I met him on set that day, right? And so I came in, I decided I was going to sit on his desk. And I went to sit on his desk and I slipped right off. And Joe did not yell cut. He kept the take. And I think I didn't it make it in the movie? Don't I do that little slip right there in the movie? Or it's in the blooper reel. One
well, they
or
should
the
have
other.
kept it. They
I think he kept it annoying Joe.
so doing all this, knowing that you're now part of the golden era of Hollywood, and to me, in comparison, this movie is the best werewolf movie of the 1980s, because Joe Dante's directing, your guys is talented acting, and it. The special effects, the makeup, it just it's a perfect werewolf movie. I mean yeah, but there's that long transition in the office, we know, with Robert Picardo. This
Why do you laugh?
is that long transition from Robert Picardo being transformed into a human to a werewolf. I'm still watching, is this guy done yet? I mean, he's just taking forever to turn into a werewolf.
Yeah, it was kind of a slow process because they're literally like in Gremlins, there's like a whole slew of people blowing through straws to make his arms puff and all of that, right? There's a bunch of guys on their knees going, blowing through these straws. it's like people say, is it really scary to do these movies? I'm like, no, it's really funny. You know, you can't help but laugh. I mean, it's just hysterical, you know, what it looks like to an audience and what you're actually
Yeah.
doing.
But you kept your composure. It's all that matters.
Yeah, no, you can't blow the ticket. You have to believe it.
No breaking
You don't
character,
believe
damn
it, no one's gonna
it.
believe it,
Because I had can't break
right?
character while filming such a good movie. So, what is your favorite scene in the entire movie?
In that movie, I would say probably, I really loved working with Dee when we were on the beach, but it was shot so far away, it's hard to get the intimacy or the feeling of what was going on between us. I don't know if it really comes off or not, but I really loved working with her that day. It was really fun. And Chris was there, and it was just like we were all there, you know, and it was, and I went when John. Carradine, when John was working, because I wanted to meet him. I had done Cannonball with Bobby and David, and I wanted to meet the dad, you know. So I went to watch him shoot. That was a really favorite day, even though I didn't have anything to do with those scenes. I really loved meeting Slim and John and all those the boys, as Chris says. Have you met the boys? One of my favorite lines. And you know, the scene with John Sayles, I have to say, because during that scene that we were shooting in the morgue, John turns to me and he says, "You know, I wrote this part for you." I said, "What? What do you mean?" He said, "There wasn't a Terry Fisher in the book, but I loved so much what you do with Betsy in Piranha that I took that character and wrote her into this script." I was so floored. And so flattered. I mean, that was really cool. That was just so cool. I
He's
just
awesome.
adore John Sayles. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Now that I'm sorry, we're getting low on time. So I was wondering if any upcoming movies or projects you can tell us about, something to look forward to.
Well, they're doing a documentary right now on horror films that they've asked me to do. I do it mid-April or something. I don't know exactly what it is, but I know that there's a lot of different actors from different horror films coming together to make this documentary, which I think will be very interesting to people like you know, people who are big fans of these kinds of movies. I have a feeling it's going to be a really awesome documentary. I'm really excited to be a part of it. And right now, I've really retired from acting, unless Joe calls. I've done 12 movies with Joe, so you know, if Joe calls, I would do it, you know. But I really. When I was really little, like before I heard God speak to me, I used to, like when I was 3 and 4 and like that, you know, my mom would put us to bed and then she'd come in later, make sure the covers were on us and all of that. I was never in bed. I mean, she could never find me, you know. I just my whole life, I remember my mom going, "Belinda, Belinda, where are you?" You know, and I would just shrink down and get really little, like, "Please don't find me." And then she would find me. I'd usually be in a closet or under the stairs or in a back room or somewhere drawing. I was always drawing. And she would say, "What are you doing?" And I'm like, "I'm drawing." And she's like, "What are you drawing?" And I'm like, "I'm drawing lightning bugs, you know?" I called them lightning bugs. But I was in an incessant drawer from very, very young. And so when I retired, I just really wanted to get back to my art. And that's what I've been doing. And now I've gotten so many things going on about my art right now that's so exciting. I mean, it's a world I don't know, and it's there is a whole bunch of information to understand about the business of art. And you know, slowly but surely I'm gaining ground, you know. But I've been approached by umpteen different people wanting me to do solo shows and all kinds of things. So we'll see what happens. I'm very excited. I got 7 different letters in the last 2 weeks.
Wow.
Yeah,
So
so it's very exciting.
That sounds fantastic. I'm happy for you. I mean, that
Okay.
sounds great. Sounds like a great
And the other
opportunity.
thing that I've been doing, like while I was an actor, because there's so much time that you're not working, is I've always been around musicians because my mother was a musician, and I just think that's kind of, I would always fall into that place. And a lot of friends, musicians, and so I would shoot a lot of rock and roll. And I put together a book that I'm going to self-publish, and hopefully that will come out in the next few years. I have
Okay.
30 plus years of shooting rock and roll, and they're mostly cause concerts, with people like Graham Nash, Jackson Browne, Bonnie Raitt, James Taylor, those guys, Doobie Brothers, etc. But because they're cause concerts, when they do them, everybody comes, like the bass player from here or the drummer from that, or it's like a mishmash of all these wonderful, wonderful musicians that give their time and energy to these various different causes. So it's called Rockin' the Causes, and watch for it.
Absolutely, I will. I'll keep an eye out for it. It sounds fascinating. And the documentary you told you just said that's coming out, I'm definitely gonna keep that on my list to watch. Because like you said, I love 1980s horror movies. It's like it that's where I would say that's where horror started from, but that's when it started getting better. It's from the 80s. And then as it progressed on, it kind of got rid of like the whole practical special effects and now they're doing CGI and like, come on guys, you did take some lessons from the actors of the 80s. I mean, you that's when the special
It's
effects
true.
and makeup was good. So now
It's
it's now it,
true.
it
I
I'm like
mean, they were so innovative, they just, I mean, Rob Bottin in The Howling, the things he brought to The Howling and that werewolf were just cutting edge, just major cutting edge special effects. And it really, I hear, it was inspiring to so many different people. Before that, it was stop time or whatever it's called, where they would take a frame and a frame and a frame and then put it
stop motion.
together, stop motion. And that doesn't work, and it never did. Even when we were kids watching it, we knew that this was not real. It would kick us out of the movie, right? I mean, it did me. I would think, though, this is really, but movies like King Kong and things like that, were movies that I absolutely loved. I don't think of them as horror films. I think of them as more psychological thrillers, really. There's just so much depth to the story, and I think that's what separates The Howling from other horror films is John Sayles and his writing.
I totally agree. I agree 110%. So, that's all the time we got. I appreciate you taking the time out from your schedule to sit down with me and talk about your role in the Howling. I really appreciate it. I am honored, and it's the pleasure is all mine. You're such a legend in Hollywood. I'm so happy I got the chance to talk to you, and I
Thank you,
wish you
Dan.
nothing but success in your career, your art career,
Thank
and
you.
hopefully I get to see you in some more movies. I mean, you're a timeless actress, and I'd love to see you in more movies. I mean, you started the golden age, and now you have to move on and show how these young budding actors, you get to teach them a few things.
Well, we'll see, we'll
So
see what happens.
that's all I got. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the legendary, the beautiful, the talented, the wonderful Belinda Balaski. Thank you so much for joining me today. And
Thank
I will possibly see you on the big screen.
you. Possibly.